And once again, welcome back to Hawk TV. This is segment 3 of episode 2. And thank you for tuning in to KFAN.com. Again, next week, it's Paul Allen. We're going to cut open a vein. I'm going to do everything I can. If I have to kick him in the sack, I'm going to make that guy cry. Wait and see. Keri Noble's been my guest, and I've really enjoyed this. Thank you. I could go on all day asking you all these questions.
I feel like I'm like the super downer musician today.
No.
I'm used to like making jokes with you and stuff, and I feel like today we're talking about like... just couldn't do it, you know?
Yeah, no, that, I think that's really interesting for me, though. But again, I don't mean to harp on it, but you know Don in Rocket Club, my band? I guarantee you he feels the same way you do. And I honestly, I'm not trying to put myself down or anything. I'm saying it. I think there may be a separating fact between people like me who literally would do anything for it and people like you who could give a crap. You know what I mean? I think there's a separating thing there. And I think that's okay.
Yeah.
You know? I wouldn't say you are a miserable artist type person.
No.
But the greatest people, the greatest artists ever, Picasso, those people, you know, they're tortured. They're tortured individuals.
Yeah. Well, you know, I think the good thing is that early on I felt pretty tortured. I really did. You know. And over the years I've worked out a lot of the things that I had issues with early on. And so now I feel like I can still draw from them, but I also feel like at my shows, I'm a better performer because I have learned how to give the crowds to some extent what they want, get that kind of balance. Because it's one thing for me to feel the way that I feel about my career and my music on my personal level.
Yeah.
But when people pay to come see you, I'm much more interested in giving them what they want and compromising so that I make sure to do songs that they want as well.
Sure.
As opposed to just like, this is just, that's where I think I'm different than some artists who feel like they take it all the way, which is like,
yeah,
I don't have any problem with you paying money to watch me do what makes me happy.
Yeah. Right. Right.
You know?
Yeah. By the way, KeriNoble.com, and check her out on Facebook as well. That's one of the great things about a Keri Noble show as well. And I would say this, whether you're sitting here or not, is how you communicate with the crowd. I think that's hilarious. I think it's very, and again, you said it during the break and maybe you even said it when we came back here, but you're not a downer as a performer at all. It's the exact opposite of that, but I'd encourage you to go see it. All right, quick questions.
Yes.
Here we go. We already asked about the son or daughter. By the way, one aspect about that, if you had a kid, would it change daughter or son? Has it been harder for you, do you think, as a woman in the music business?
I hate that question.
I know you do, but I had to ask.
I think it has.
Yeah.
But luckily,
why
the
do you hate the question?
Because I think it's an easy question. No offense to you.
No, it's okay.
I think it's an easy question. I think everybody always kind of, you know, pins the male to the female. The reality is it's hard. It's a hard job. It's a hard job to break into. And, you know, I feel like if I say, yes, it is harder being a woman, that there will be some people who will be like, oh, there's the girl card, you know what I mean? But it is, you know, it definitely is. And but I don't think it's held me back a ton because the kind of music that I do has a lot of female strong,
right,
you know, voices in it. So on some levels though, I think, yeah, I think it has, you know, there's a pressure that I don't know that guys have when you're dealing with labels and things to be number one. There's pressure. Men don't have as much pressure about how they look.
Oh, absolutely not.
So it doesn't matter how good I sound or how great my songs are. If I've let myself go, then I'm gross. You know, it doesn't matter. I wouldn't get anywhere. But then also there's a little flirty quotient where, you know, when it's mostly men at the top, you know, and so there's this expectation that you've got to be a little flirty and, you know, use whatever you can use to get there.
Right.
And that's a bummer, you know, because I don't think men have to deal with that as much.
If I were answering the question I just asked, I'm telling you, I would be much more apt to encourage my son to go into music than my daughter, just because of what I've seen.
Well, if you get a good manager,
you
know, if you have a good kind of team that you employ as opposed to the label employing them, that helps.
There's a large gap of time between starting and having a manager, though. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's true.
That's the hardest part. Do you have a scar that tells a story?
I saw that question, and I was thinking about it. The only scar, I definitely don't have any kind of major scars. I just have a chicken pox scar that's on my lower eyelid. And
yeah, we can all see that.
Yeah, everybody mentions it. No, I don't really have any scars. I've gotten through life so far pretty unscathed.
All right. What's the best advice you ever received?
For me, the best advice is when you know better, you do better. I feel like there is a lot of pressure to be perfect all the time, you know? Mm-hmm. And sometimes I think I'm thinking in my mind, particularly of one time in my life where I made choices that were bad. And I knew they were wrong, but I didn't understand how wrong they were and how it would just not just affect the people around me, but how it would really affect me. And when I heard that phrase, when you know better, you do better, I realized sometimes you have to make mistakes in order to learn about yourself and do better. And know that you're not going to do it again, you know? And I think it applies to many, many different things. But when you know better, you do better. I believe that.
If you were to go back in time and talk to your 18-year-old self, what would you tell you?
I would say it's not that serious. Hmm. It's all going to be fine. It's not that serious. And you'll find people like you. You won't be the only one forever.
Wow, people like you. Mm-hmm. What do you mean by that?
When I left the church, I felt like I was on the outside and I didn't know, I was pretty sheltered. Like I did not know that people could not go to church and also not be completely screwed up. I think the idea was if you are not like majorly in church and majorly in that world, that you're a drunk, you're a druggie, you're super sexually loose, you're all of those awful things. And, you know, that's not the case.
Right.
And I think I just felt completely lost and like, this doesn't fit that you guys are trying to keep me in, but I'm so afraid of what I'll be if I leave.
If you weren't a little bit screwed up, would you be able to play music as well as you do?
No. Mm-mm. Hmm. No, it just comes with it.
Yeah, sort of. Are you happy?
Yes.
Right now, as you look at me, you're a happy person?
For the most part.
That's good.
Yeah.
Would you have said that when you were 18?
No. Yeah. No. Definitely not. Huh.
What's the best song Keri Noble's ever written? I didn't put that one on
the
list.
Well, are we speaking of her or am I? Yeah. You didn't put that on the list. What?
I didn't because I didn't want you to know it was coming. I wanted this to come off the top of your head.
You know what? I'm going to be really honest. Giving You My Love is my best song. And you're on that song, mm-hmm. and I'm not saying that because of that, although you enhance it. I wrote that song. I think some of the best songs are simple. You know, they don't all have to be super complicated. And that song, I think people really can relate to.
Yeah.
And I'm proud of it. I'm proud that it's simple. I'm proud that it's not complicated. I'm proud that I think people can relate to it, you know? And it's got a more positive spin to it, you know, as opposed to, like, being a really heavy, dark song.
Of songs that have made it to record, what's the worst song Keri Noble's ever written?
We don't have time. I mean, there's...
Name one that you are just embarrassed about. There's
well, if I do
something.
That, then people will listen to it.
Of
They'll find it.
Of course we will. That's why I want you to answer.
Well, you know what? I'll tell you. My first two CDs, which I recorded in Detroit, I don't sell. Like, I don't even have them.
Really?
I mean, I think I have them somewhere in my basement, like, hidden away, but
what
I won't
were they
even
called?
Sell them. One is called Lullaby. You can find it on eBay for like $50 or $150 or something like it.
Wow.
At one point it was like $500. I mean, people, the more, you know, the problem is the more I make it hard to get, the more people want it.
Yeah, right. Oh,
but I'm telling you, don't waste your money because it's awful. Every single song on that record, on both of those records, awful.
So now that you're 25 years old, Keri Noble, final question before we throw it to our musical guest.
For the record, I'm 36. I got no issues
with
that.
Okay, cool. I didn't know if you wanted me to go with that or not.
Yeah. No, that's another thing I don't believe in.
Good.
Yeah.
What are you going to do with the next 36 years?
I'd like to have a family. I would like to have a baby at some point. I know there's not tons of time left, but I think that it's possible, and sure. I would like to have a family. I would like to get much more into writing and less into touring, you know, and I don't know, explore options where I get to be, you know, as free as I can be.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Maybe do morning radio for a living.
Do morning radio for a living.
Write
Why
more
not?
Songs like you did for Kelly Clarkson, that kind of thing you're talking about.
Yeah.
I can definitely see that happening.
Thank you.
It's been a true pleasure.
Thank
have you.
You
on Hawk TV.
Thank you
I
for
hope
having
it wasn't too
me.
Painful for you.
No, I hope it wasn't too much of a downer.
wasn't a downer at all. I can't wait to see what Meat Sauce was writing behind us.
I know,
he's
I'm
just
so
been
nervous.
Scratching and scratching and scratching back there. Speaking of Meat Sauce, special treat.
Okay.
We go now, for the second consecutive week, to our special musical guest, Paul Lambert.
Oh, awesome.
Thank you. I'm Meat Sauce Paul Lambert, and I'm here to do another rendition of a song I didn't write, but Madonna wrote it, and it goes a little something like this. Life is a mystery. Everyone must stand alone. I hear you call my name, and it feels like home. Midnight hour, I can hear your power just like a prayer. It's like a little prayer.
Well, there you go. That's our musical guest, Paul Lambert, because we can't afford to pay a real musical guest. In fact, we had Keri Noble in here, and she wouldn't do it for free.
No way.
So even though you were the guest on today's show, Paul Lambert, again, had to be the special musical guest. We'll do our best to secure a better musical guest for next week's Episode 3 with Paul Allen. Keri, it's been a pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you for being on Hawk TV. Good luck with the next 36 years and beyond.
Thank you.
Take care. Thank you for tuning in to Hawk TV. We'll see you next week.